saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. And I believe in signs and wonders, and I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Is that true? My praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Oh, and our God will finish what He started. This is my testimony from death to life. This grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
Well, how many can agree that God is not done with us? He is always moving, He always has good plans, amen? Sing, if I'm not dead.
If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead and you're not done, greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead and you're not done, greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead and you're not done, greater things are still to come. This is my testimony from death to life. Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. This grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
Well, let's put our hands together, make some noise this morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome to All Nations Church. My name's Pastor Rick, and this is my friend Stu, and
howdy.
We are glad you're here today.
We're so excited that everybody's here.
Can we give it up for those newcomers that are here?
Yeah.
Woo! We're glad you're here this morning. Thanks for coming. As I said, I'm Pastor Rick, and we'd love to connect with you. If you'd like to know more about All Nations Church, there's a little card on the back of the chair in front of you. If you'd fill that out and leave it in the basket on the way out, we will promise to only send you one email a week.
Just one.
Friday afternoon, just explain what's going on at the church, how you can get involved, and a little bit more about the church. And I'll call you and just see how I can encourage you in your walk with Jesus. That's the most important thing we do, is develop our relationship with God and grow in Him. So we'd love to help you do that. At All Nations Church, our vision is to bring all nations to Christ. That's the foundation, why we're here. That's our hope for you and all our neighbors. And we help people get to know Him through our relationship with God, through celebrating life together and growing in relationships with other people. So thanks for joining us this morning.
Yeah, I was super excited. We're just privileged that you'd spend the last day of the year with us and to be mm-hmm. here this morning. So we're excited. And with looking back on 2023, we've been through a lot of different spaces, some highs, some lows. But what we do know is that God is with us and he's preparing a time for you.
Yeah.
He's made a time and prepared a time like this for you. And so there's this one piece in Exodus that that always comes to mind when we're thinking of a new year, and it's Exodus 23:20. It says, "See, I am sending an angel ahead of you to guard you along the way and to bring you into a place that I've prepared." Mm-hmm. Wherever you have been, it's time to look forward. He's preparing a great place for you.
Yeah.
And so as we go today, worship him today, be with him today, come with us and get ready for what he's got in store for you.
Hey, let's worship him right into 2024.
Let's go.
Redeemed by his grace.
hearts, we give praise. So praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord, oh, Lord. Oh, let it start here and now. Oh, praise. Calls out curse.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain.
Church, we started it on the foundation that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. He is the center of everything. He created all things. All things exist for His purpose. All things are held together by Him. When we declare the name of Jesus, we're inviting the kingdom of God to move on behalf of our circumstances in any situation. You might be in here today, you've got a situation you need healing. You may need an economic breakthrough. You may need a relational breakthrough. You may need a financial breakthrough. As we declare the name of Jesus in that circumstance, we declare all the kingdom of God to flow in that area. We declare restoration and God's purpose and priority to manifest in your life through Him. So we are going to sing this again, and I encourage you, you may not be used to church, you may not be used to declaring things by faith, but I tell you, try it today. What circumstance are you facing? What circumstance do you need God to move in? Begin to declare there is power in that circumstance. In the name of Jesus. Is anybody with me this morning? Somebody give me a head nod or say, yeah, we're going to declare this. Are you ready? Here we go.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
Circumstances right now, supernaturally, God, we release you right now to move and have your way. Bring healing, bring restoration, bring an understanding of one another so that there could be unity. Father God, we declare it done. We release you now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Within your presence, I speak Jesus. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break.
Here and now,
declaring there is hope and there is freedom. Jesus, your name is power, and your name is healing. From the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Good morning, All Nations Church. Woohoo! I'm feeling good. It's nice and warm in here. It's toasty. It's going to be great. If I haven't had the honor to meet you yet, my name is Caitlin Uliak, and I am the Director of Youth Ministries, as well as the Junior Leader Coordinator. So that's a whole lot of teenagers in the span of a week. But it's a lot of fun. They keep me young. They keep me on my toes. And it's been an amazing year. I've been in this role for a year now, and I had approached Pastor Rick a year and a half ago after completing 21 days of fasting and prayer, and just felt God say to me, like, you're meant to lead the youth. Thought I was out to lunch, so I went to Pastor Rick on a Sunday and said, hey, Pastor Rick, I need to talk to you about something. And he said, I also need to talk to you about something. And that was on a Sunday. It was super busy. So after church on Sunday, we both live in Abbasand, packed up my child, packed up our dog, and went on a little mosey down the street, knocked on his door, said, hey, I think I'm meant to lead youth. And he said, hey, I think you are too. So a year and a half has passed, and we were doing Youth Nation every second Thursday because we have a toddler, was pregnant, had a baby, and work in the mix of it. But it has been So much fun. And all to say this, that we are super excited because as of January 4th, we will be going to every Thursday here from 7 till 8:30. So we're super pumped. It's going to be amazing. And as of January 12th, that will be our 1 year of having Youth Nation consistently. And it's been an awesome experience. I've seen God call out these amazing gifts and talents in each of these young pioneers for the faith that I loved getting to know them over the last year. And also downstairs, we've witnessed our junior leaders just grow in their leadership, grow in taking on more responsibility. And just genuinely want to pour into your guys' kids downstairs in Kid Nation. And it's been so fun just to be a part of and just witnessing all this happen. My husband Carter and I are both born and raised in Fort McMurray. I know we're little unicorns. We're kind of rare. We're rare here now. And we have two little boys, Levi and Noah. Levi is going to be 3 in March, and Noah is only 4 months. So still super fresh little bean, and also born and currently being raised in Fort McMurray. We love our community. We love being a part of All Nations Church, and we love being a part of God's vision for it. But Pastor Rick and Kathy, they have the biggest heart for Fort McMurray and for the region, and just their mission to make Christ known. And we're so grateful that we get to be included on this mission, and it's always an honor to preach the word. So I'm thankful that Pastor Rick has called me up to do that, little youth pastor. So let's jump right into the word. Psalms 127 verse 1 says, "Unless the Lord builds the house, those who build it labor in vain." While we're on the verge of another year, it's easy for us to start dreaming and planning and kind of jump to getting things in motion even before the new year begins tomorrow. And it's what we're hoping for, what 2024 could look like for us as individuals and for our families. But while we're one day away from the new year, I want to challenge all of us to consider who is building our house. So let's pray. Father God, I thank you for 2023. I thank you for the highs, the lows, the ups and downs. I thank you for your faithfulness. But we know that you already know in advance what 2024 will look like. So we just pray, God, that you would just open up our hearts to help prepare us for what you have in store for this next year. Use me as a vessel and speak through me. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So in the spirit of it being New Year's Eve, a few years ago, I had made the New Year's resolution that I was going to run a half marathon. When they talk about goal setting, they start small. I did not do that. I jumped to the full-on marathon, half marathon, sorry. Not the 2-kilometer run, not the 5-kilometer, not the 10, the full half marathon. But when COVID has shut everything down, I had nowhere to prep or train, and I wasn't even a runner at this point. Apparently, there's form for running. I didn't know that at that point either. So my husband, the amazing, supportive husband that he is, have found a treadmill on Facebook Marketplace, steal the deal, in perfect condition, and went and got it. And I vividly remember the day in March. It was calm, blue skies, not a cloud. Like, it was perfect, the best day. So we go to this woman's house, and Carter had it in his mind. Oh, yeah, Caitlin, you're strong enough. You can do it. No. So we get to this woman's house, and we start loading up the treadmill into the back of his truck. She was there. She was able to help. But once we got to our home, which I would like to point out was a rental, we were not owning this home. It was a little bit more of a struggle. It was a full-on blizzard by this point, by the time we got home. So me and my husband are dragging this treadmill up our driveway towards our front door in a blizzard. We get to the front door, and we barely get it through the front door. Like, I mean by millimeters. We barely get this thing through the door, and we also take off the front porch light in the process. We get inside. I need to rest. Like, that was a lot. I'm not even ready for the half marathon. I'm not even ready for a 2-kilometer run, let alone a half marathon. I can't even move the treadmill. So I go and I sit down on the couch, have a little rest, and he's eyeing up the treadmill. He's looking at the treadmill, and he's eyeing up our L-shaped stairwell, not straight down. L-shaped. There's a turn. There's a corner. And he looks at me and goes, "Caitlin, I think we could do it. I think me and you can do it. All in one piece." No, no, no. Like, we had talked about this. You were going to take it apart tomorrow, and we'd move it down in parts, and then we'd put it back together. No, Caitlin, I think we can do it. I think me and you can do this. I'm like, you don't want to call a friend. You don't want to call a friend. Like, there's people. We have neighbors. Do you want to call a friend and do this? No, I think you got it. I think you're strong enough to do this. He clearly had more faith in my strength than I had in myself for this entire experience. So he talks me into it. He's just like, yeah, Caitlin, like, tomorrow you could get up. You could practice your run. Start training tomorrow. The supportive, motivational husband that he was. Yeah, start tomorrow. Start tomorrow. You'll wake up tomorrow and you'll start to do it. So off we go. Carrying this massive treadmill through the doorway, which is significantly more narrower than our front door, we get stuck. It did not take long at all for us to get stuck in the stairwell. I'm being crushed at my end. He's holding the majority of the weight. And next thing we know, there's some dents in the sides of the walls. And not just minor scuffs, like full-on fist-size holes from the treadmill on both sides of the stairwell. After that, it had slid out of our hands and went through the bottom landing. So by this point, I'm thinking this was the worst idea ever. Who said New Year's resolutions were a good idea? And we're like, well, we can't get around the corner. We can't get it back up. So we're just kind of stuck there. And we had even taken parts off of the treadmill to try to make it narrower again to get around the corner or to bring it back up. And it did no good. So eventually we mustered up the strength on his part, not mine, and brought it back up the stairs, but we got stuck in the door frame. So naturally that got ripped off too. Again, this was a rental. We did not own this house at all. We still have that treadmill today. It's in our garage. The panel's propped up with a towel, and the handles have zip ties all around it, but it works, which is a miracle in this whole adventure. And you could ask Carter. I've been wanting to get rid of that treadmill for the last 6 months, Pastor Rick. It's still there. It's like a monument now. It's like a trophy for him. But because we were a young married couple who knew nothing about home maintenance, this was a conversation piece in our house. People walk in like, oh, what happened to your walls? Well, let me tell you about this treadmill that I own. But my mother-in-law had come up and she taught us about, okay, you need a piece of drywall, you need to make sure it's flush, you gotta put plaster paint on it, then you gotta sand it down, and then you gotta paint it. And she really did make it look as good as new. Needless to say, we made a mess of our walls. Thankfully, we got back our damage deposit, and I may or may not have ended up running that half marathon after all. Maybe this year. I'll start with the 2 kilometer. But we all have good intentions of building something with our lives. Maybe it's a savings account. Maybe it's building a name for ourselves, building a business, building good habits, building a stronger marriage, building a legacy to pass on to our kids. None of these aspirations are bad, and neither is building them. But in order for things to last, we must build God's way. If we want it to be sustained into 2024 and beyond, we must follow His blueprint and His design. There's a story in 2 Kings 18 that we're briefly going to look at today. Verse 1. Hezekiah, son of Ahaz, began to rule over Judah in the third year of King Hoshea's reign in Israel. He was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 29 years. His mother was Abijah, the daughter of Zechariah. He did what was pleasing in the Lord's sight, just as David had done. He removed the pagan shrines, smashed the sacred pillars, and cut down the Asherah pole. He broke up the bronze serpent that Moses had made because the people of Israel had been offering sacrifices to it. The bronze serpent was called Nehushtan. Hezekiah trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel. There was no one like him among all the kings of Judah, either before or after his time. He remained faithful to the Lord in everything, and he carefully obeyed all the commands the Lord had given Moses. Hezekiah was a very passionate ruler. He knew that God was the one and only God and ensured that every idol that the people of Judah were worshiping be taken down. There are 3 things I think we can learn from Hezekiah. Verse 4 says that he removed. This building that we get to worship in every Sunday did not always look like this. It was actually a much older church. And the pastors had approached Pastor Rick and Kathy last year asking if we would like to buy it. When the leadership team came in, we needed to check to see if there's potential here, potential for the building, potential for the land, see what we could do with this, and also try to see the vision for All Nations Church through Pastor Rick's eyes. And truthfully, I felt like Ty Pennington from Extreme Home Makeover, saying, that wall has to go, that one has to be knocked out, those solid oak doors, they got to go. We need to paint the entire building. The purple carpet in the sanctuary, that got to go. Like, we got to rip that up. That should have been ripped up years ago. The entire basement needs to be flattened and rebuilt. Like, we needed to do so much work on this building. As we walked around, everything felt so tight and crowded. And they obviously went through with the deal, and the construction and the renovation work began. Some of the walls had to stay for structural integrity. Somehow we installed a slide according to fire code. But the old had to be torn down so we can build God's vision for All Nations Church and be in alignment with his plan. After a lot of work, we moved into this building in February this last year with many renovations and work still happening. We built a back deck on. We had the trailer, did renos in the trailer. The definition of renovation is the act or process of repairing, renewing, or restoring to good condition. God is in the business of renovations. In order for renovations to happen, though, we need to be willing to go under the process of repairing, renewing, and restoring. Hezekiah removed the pagan shrines, smashed the sacred pillars, and cut down the Asherah pole. What are things that need to be removed from your life for the Lord to be able to build? Is it an old way of thinking? Is it a bad habit? Maybe for you, before you head into this next year, you need to come clean and invite some accountability into your life. And the best example that I can think of is through life groups. These people come around you, they come along beside you, and they hold you accountable to help you become the person that God's created for you to be. When we are people of limited capacity, for God to have room to build in you and I, there are things that needs to be removed at the same time. Hezekiah removed the bronze serpent, which wasn't a bad thing initially. Moses made it for the Israelites to bring on healing when they were bitten by snakes. It was actually an Old Testament representation of Jesus, but the people of Judah had turned it into an idol. What good things have become our focus and attention that aren't God things? What good things have we pursued in 2023 that need to be removed for us to be effective in 2024? My second point. It then says that he broke up again in verse 4. And we can unpack this a few different ways. Literally breaking up is putting an end to something. Maybe it's an end of a toxic relationship before you end the year and go into 2024. Maybe a friendship or relationship that isn't beneficial and you're living in full awareness of that. Maybe there's some unhealthy behaviors that needs to change. Procrastination. My husband pointed that one out to me. I don't know. It's a blind spot. That's why they call it blind spots. You can't see them. Complaining, constantly making excuses, or some beliefs that you've believed about yourself, that I'm not good enough, God can't use me, I've hit my max in my relationship with God, I have nothing to offer, I don't have time to be part of a small group or join a team. And if I could speak to the part about joining a team, we're always wanting more hands on deck in all of our teams. There is always a way for you to be included in what we're doing here at All Nations Church. 3 years ago, we started our church in a school, and we had one service. And now look where we are. We have three services, and we have our own building. At the Christmas Eve service last week, we had enough people to be setting up chairs in the cafe for overflow. More people coming means we need more hands on deck so others can experience God. We could also look to more verses from the Bible, Jeremiah 4:3. The Lord says to the people of Judah, break up your unplowed ground and do not sow among thorns. Hosea 10:12 has a similar verse. Sow righteousness for yourself, reap the fruit of unfailing love, and break up your unplowed ground for his time to seek the Lord. We understand the principle of sowing and reaping. We talk about it with our time and our gifts and our treasures. What we sow is what we will reap. The Bible also talks about those who sow generously will reap generously. The catch, though, is that we can't sow if the ground is hard. We cannot sow if areas of our hearts are hard, caused by bitterness, jealousy, anger, pride, envy, disappointment, rejection, or fear. A year of good fruit cannot be reaped when there are parts of our hearts that are still hard and not surrendered to the Lord. It is time to break up. The last thing that we can learn from Hezekiah from this text was that he remained faithful in verse 6. prior to Hezekiah's reign, the Israelites were led farther and farther away from God. He came in like a wrecking ball, cue Miley Cyrus, clearly I'm in youth, and set something straight. He brought alignment with God for the people, but also knew that they were called to be set apart from the other nations. It would have cost him his reputation and would have came with much resistance and tension as he guided the people back to God. But despite adversity, he remained faithful. You and I have been called to be set apart. Living a life that is different and that makes a difference requires going against the grain and against popular opinion. Doing things God's way might not make sense to people around you. It might not make sense to your family. It might not make sense to your friends or your coworkers. And it might cost you your reputation, and you might come against some resistance. But like Samuel 22:26, it says, to be faithful, you show yourself faithful. But when God gives you a promise, we have to be willing to go through the process. It's an act of surrender. He will be faithful to those that are faithful. When we took over this building, I'm sure Pastor Rick didn't know how it was all going to come about, but he trusted, because we had conversations weekly, that the right people would be in on this project, that it would be done according to time, and he trusted God's timing and trusted that if God was going to give us this building, he would give us the people to make it happen. And it's the same in our personal lives. Looking back at 2023, I think we all clearly see areas of our lives, like our basement walls, that got pretty banged up. The damage could have been wrongfully done to you. The damage could have been brought on by a decision that you made. And sometimes we attempt to deal with the damage on our own. We try to do our own renovations without the Lord's help, like looking for a DIY YouTube channel video just to make it a little bit easier, but end up making a massive mess of it instead. But I believe that the Lord wants to do some removal today, some repairs today, and some refining, and ultimately some rebuilding. For us to have a fresh start in this next year, we have to hand over control over to Jesus. Unless he builds in us and through us, we will labor in vain. It will all be for nothing and won't amount to anything eternal. However, as we faithfully hand over control to the Master Builder, he will faithfully complete the good work that he started in each of us. I believe that God has called each of us in this space on the last day of 2023 to firstly show us that we made it. 2023 was hard. There was a lot of highs. There was a lot of lows. There was moments of great difficulty and hardship, but there was also great moments of great joy. Whatever mess you might feel like you're in this morning, it's okay. You made it. There's areas of your life that might just feel like an absolute disaster, again, like our basement walls, but you came through these front doors, and that's huge. But before the ball drops and the clock strikes midnight tonight, we all have an opportunity for a fresh start, for a rebuild on Christ, the solid rock. We're going to do something a little bit different this morning. I'm going to invite you to stand. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to allow us all to re-up our commitment to Jesus and his best plan for our lives. Maybe there was something that stuck out to you this morning that needs to be knocked down. Maybe there's a barrier or a wall. Maybe it's a lie that you've been believing or a situation that you're stuck in and you feel restricted and stuck and you can't get out of it. If that's you today, I believe that God wants to knock it down here in this moment so you can start tomorrow of 2024 fresh and allow him to rebuild you back up, to build up upon the foundation that you already have. Like I mentioned, procrastination is something that I need to knock down today. If that's you, I'm going to count to the count of three, and if you could just slip your hand up and we'll pray. On the count of three. One, two, three. Amazing. Lord Jesus, I thank you. I thank you for the hands that are raised. I thank you for everything that you brought us through 2023, the highs and the lows. And I thank you, God, that you know what 2024 already holds. But the barriers that are in the way, God, the walls that are in the way, that are keeping us at a distance from you, God, I pray that you would come in and knock them down and completely destroy them to the point where there's nothing left. That there's nothing that can be even somewhat put together, God, that you would completely destroy these walls that keep us from you. We want you to come into our life, Lord Jesus. We want you to rebuild. Maybe you're in the room today and you've never made the decision to follow Jesus. There's truly no better way to start 2024 than by making him your personal Lord and Savior. That's a decision that doesn't just affect you today, but into all of eternity. You are the brand new building project. I'm going to count to three again. And if you want to either rededicate or make that commitment to follow Jesus, I'll get you to slip up your hand. This is a private moment. One, two, three. Awesome. All Nations Church, let's say this prayer together. Dear Jesus, I need you. I know you have a plan for me. I surrender my life and my ways. Come into my life. I trust you with my future. Amen. Can we give it up for everybody that made that decision today? It truly is the best way to finish off a year going into 2024. But I believe that God has great things in store for us all. And I don't mean to sound cliche or sugarcoat anything, but if I've learned anything is that your relationship with God is always an exciting one, that there's always something new, that there's always, when you wake up in the morning, it's just like, okay, now what, God? Now what? When you think you haven't figured out, there's always something new. So I hope you guys each have a wonderful New Year's Eve and abundant blessings for 2024. I will see y'all next year.
Let's sing There's Joy.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. Do you want to duet? We're going to finish this year in fine form. No? No.
It'll be so good. Pastor Rick baptized the second service with the water, so it was good.
That's right. Well, we're glad you're here. If you made a decision to follow Christ today, did I just steal your part?
That's okay. Okay. Go. You run.
If you made a decision to trust in Christ today, the most important thing you'll do is tell someone about it. And we made that easy for you by filling out the few... providing that card. If you fill it out, we'll get back to this week and show you how we can grow together and help you in your journey with Christ. It's the most important thing that you get to know him through his word and get connected to his body. And so we would love to help you with that.
Amen.
Go ahead.
Yeah. And if you made that decision today, it's the best thing you can do is just share with us. And so we'll be up here praying. If you need any prayer for today, any prayers for some new things for 2024 and some renovations, let's give it up one more time for Caleb. What is an amazing message, eh? God has great things for us. And the beautiful thing is that he always talks about restoring us, that we will always be restored in him. And there's promises many, many times. Yep. One of the ones that I love is in Isaiah. And it's Isaiah 40:31, where he says, But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up like wings, like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. And so whatever you have going on in 2023, be reminded that if you start looking to God and letting him follow you, in 2024, yeah, you will not be weary and not be faint.
Yeah.
A good friend of mine said that you can't drive a car by looking through the rearview mirror. You'll always end up crashing. And so we've got to look ahead to what God's got us for 2024. We can use that rearview mirror to see what we've learned and for safety, but we've got to look ahead. He's got a great plan for you, and have an absolutely great, amazing 2024.
Yeah, that's right. We're so thankful. God's done so many things through you this year, through your talents, your treasures, and your time. And we just give thanks to God for that. Today is the last day you can give towards this year's legacy campaign.
Amen.
And so if you'd like to do that, it's easy. Go to allnationschurch.co or go to the...
Hotspot.
There's somebody at the back, I believe. And again, you'll get a tax receipt early in February. Thank you so much for your giving, whether it's financially or whether it's your time or your talents. We sure appreciate that. We remind you of the scripture in Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness," or right living with him, and then all these other things will be given back to you. And
Amen.
God is faithful. As we've sown a seed, he will multiply it. So if you've served people and cared for people, you're going to be more efficient in raising your children. If you've looked after people, he'll send other people to look after your
kids.
That's right. God is faithful. He is on the throne. And as we submit and yield our lives to him, he just comes in abundant ways into our lives. So thank you for your generosity. We promise to use what you give to bring people to Christ. That's our hope. That's what we believe he's going to help us do. And we covenant with you to do that.
Absolutely.
Can I pray with you before we finish today? I want to bless you. May the Almighty God bless you with an understanding of who he is, that you would understand the love of God that surpasses all understanding, that you would know the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, that you would know the grace and the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you would walk forth and excel in your relationships, excel in your learnings, excel in all things related to the kingdom of God. We bless you now in the mighty name of Jesus, in the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. God bless you. We'll see you in 2024.
Amen.
We're going into the book of James. It's going to be amazing.
Woo!
See you next year.